Welcome to Algebra 1AB. We're going to start off Chapter 3 today, Section 3.1, Day 1, on functions. And you know the first three letters of functions? Fun. Here we go. Well, the first thing we're going to do is determine whether or not a relation, and that is anything that connects an input and an output, or that connects two variables. A relation can be ordered pairs, x's and y's, you know, points that we plot. Anything that relates to things, and that's why it's called a relation. You'll see our last line there, a relation that pairs each input with exactly one output is called a function. So what we don't want one input leading to two different outputs. That's the only thing that would cause us not to have a function. So we want to be on the lookout for that. There are several different ways to describe a function. We could have an equation. We've seen those that have related x's and y's, two different variables, an input and an output. An input-output table, so x's in one column, y's in another column or rows. We could see words, we could see a graph, we could just see ordered pairs listing the points, and we could see a map where we have inputs leading to outputs, and all those we're going to cover in the lesson today. So first you can see we've got a relation given using ordered pairs, and we need to describe whether or not that relation is a function. Okay, well, let's look at all of our inputs, all of our x values. Remember, each ordered pair is given x, comma, y, where x is what's going into that function, y is what's coming out. And again, we're on the lookout for, is there the same input going to two different outputs? That's what we don't want. So I go from negative 2 to 2. I go from negative 1 to 2. Oh, those lead to the same output, but I don't have the same input going to different outputs, so I'm okay. So this right here is okay. Then I go from 0 to 2. Okay, 0 goes in, 2 comes out. That's fine. Hey, that's another one that outputs a 2. We're okay. Then input a 1, output a 0. Input a 2, output a 0. Hey, a 1 goes in, 0 comes out. And if a 2 goes in, a 0 comes out, that's also okay because we don't have the same input leading to two different outputs. So yes, this is a function. No one input, and instead of input, since they're ordered pairs, let's just say no one x goes to two different y values. All right, let's take a look at letter B. I've got 4 leading to 0. That's okay. I've got 8 leading to 7. I've got 6 leading to 4. Okay, I've got 4 leading to 3. Ooh, wait a minute. Here we said that if 4 goes in, a 0 has to come out. And then over here we said if a 4 goes in, well, that's the same input, and now they're telling me that a 3 should come out. So this is a case where, no, we do not have a function because 4 as an input, 4 as an x leads to two different y values, and those are 0 and 3. Cannot have that. That is not a function. All right, for letter C, here you can see a table. We're still getting x's and y's as inputs and outputs, and we're still looking to see if we have a function. So let's see, for an input of negative 2, I've got an output of 3. Good. Input of negative 1, output of 4. We're good. Input of 0, output of 5. Good. Input of 0, output of 6. Wait a second. No, that can't be a function because our input of 0, LEADS, leads to two different y values, two different outputs, 5 and 6. That's what we don't want. The same input going to two different outputs. All right, let's take a look at letter D. Here you can see our inputs and outputs, they show arrows. An input of -1 leads to an output of 4. This is called mapping. An input of 3 leads to an output of 15. All right. An input of 11 leads to an output of 15. Well, that is fine. Yes, that's a function because no one x leads to two different y's. And with mapping, what we don't want to see, and this is just for your reference over here, what we don't want to see is something like this. We don't want to see two arrows coming from the same input. So like if we had an input of 1 leading to 3 and 4, that's what we want to look out for. That would be a case where we do not have a function. That cannot happen. So that's a really nice thing about mapping, is that it's very easy to see with those arrows what that input is leading to. Number 5, here we've got a couple that I'd like you to try on your own. So if you could please pause the video, try these on your own. I'll check back in a couple seconds with the answer. All right, let's see what you came up with. The first one is not a function. And the reason it's not is we've got 5 leading to two different outputs. So 5 goes or maps to 0 and 10, two different outputs for that one input. For number 2, we're okay. That one is a function. Yes, it is a function because all x values lead to one y value. No one x value leads to two different y values. All right, numbers 3 and 4 here, I'd like you to pause the video again. Try these on your own using a table and mapping. Are those functions? I'll check back in a few seconds with the answer. All right, well, let's check number 3. Our inputs here are going down this column, the outputs that go with them in the second column there, and every input has its own output. So, yes, that's a function. Each x goes to 1y. And for number 4, this one is not a function because the x value of 1/2 maps to 3 different y values. Remember, that's what we don't want, arrows that are coming from the same number going to different outputs. So the same input leading different places, we don't know what to do when a 1/2 comes our way. Do I turn it into a -2? Do I turn it into a 0? Do I turn it into a 4? I don't know. It causes confusion. Now, we've looked at tables, we've looked at ordered pairs, we've looked at the mapping. Now let's take a look at graphically how we can test and see if we have a function or not. The vertical line test is a very easy way to see if we have a function. So a y value means a height, and an x value is measured on the x-axis here. So if I look and I see a place on the x-axis where I get two different heights at that same x, that's what we didn't want. And the vertical line test, if I can pass a vertical line anywhere on that graph and it crosses the graph twice, then it's not a function. So if we had something that looked like this, let's say this is our x, this is our y, even if most of it looks just fine, if there is any place where I could pass a vertical line and hit that graph more than once, that is not a function. So very, very fast way of determining from a graph if we have a function or not. So we can use this vertical line test with points or with actual lines moving across our coordinate plane. So for letter A, this is not a function because if we pass a vertical line when x equals 2, it's going to hit 2 points. The same thing will happen when x equals 5. So no, it fails the vertical line test, I'm fine with you writing VLT, it fails that when x equals 2 and x equals 5. Both of those inputs, those x's, have two different y values, outputs to go with them. For letter B, yes, this is a function because wherever I would draw a vertical line, it would only cross that graph once. So it passes the vertical line test. All right, letters C and D. Let's take a look here. Letter C. Here, anywhere I draw a vertical line through any of those points, I'm not going to cross another point. So that one is a function because it passes the vertical line test. For letter D, that answer is no. Anywhere I draw a vertical line, as soon as I'm past x equals 1, it's going to cross that graph twice, and that's what we do not want. So we could say it fails the vertical line test whenever x is greater than 1. For any x value bigger than 1, I could draw a vertical line and it would cross that graph twice. Can't have that if it's going to be a function. All right, here for the monitoring progress 5 and 6, I would like you to pause the video and see if you can't answer these two on your own. I'll check back in a few seconds with the answer. All right, hopefully we have some answers down. For number 5, yes, that one passes the vertical line test, so it is a function. And for number 6, this one also passes the vertical line test. Anywhere I would draw a vertical line on that graph, it would only cross the graph once. It's good, it's a function. For 7 and 8, again, pause the video. Try these on your own, and I'll check back in a couple seconds. All right, for number 7, we should have answered no. This graph fails the vertical line test whenever x is between 0 and 6. Ooh, so how do we write between 0 and 6? When 0, x is between those two. 0 is less than x and is less than 6. Compound inequality like we saw in chapter 2. And lastly, number 8. Yes, this one is a function. It passes the vertical line test. All right. So a common analogy to use for functions, since it's an input and an output, is like a machine. And what we need to know is, what can we describe as the raw materials going into this machine? And then there's another way to describe everything that can come out of this machine. So we have names for those mathematically. The domain of a function, those are all of the possible input values. And when we think about a graph, those are x values. And then the outputs, the range, those are y values. So you can see here, our function, our machine right here, says that to get the output, that's going to be 3 times x, 3 times whatever our input is. So the machine itself tells us a rule, how to work with our input to make an output. So you can see that if we input a negative 2, then our output would equal 3 times that negative 2. Oh, so our output equals a negative 6, and that's what they've shown us here. Negative 2 goes in, we run through our rule, and then the output is a negative 6. Okay, they also use the term set. Remember how we described sets of numbers? We used braces. So we might be saying our inputs are all x's that are bigger than 6. Our outputs are all y's that are less than 2, something like that. So those are just examples of how we can express sets of numbers using those braces. This table in your notes is just showing you some of the different ways we can look at what goes into a function, what comes out of a function. So we've already seen them labeled as input values. You see that often in tables and things like that. We've seen x values and y values. Those are when we have ordered pairs or a graph to work with. The domain is the set of all those x values. And then independent variable, dependent variable, these are often when we work with functions as word problems. So often as the result of science experiments, we will see certain inputs like time going by leading to certain outputs like how many bacteria we have. The independent variable is the time that's gone by. The dependent variable, well, it depends on the time, how much bacteria we have. So it makes sense that dependent would be our output. So this is a very useful slide for tying together when we're talking about inputs, when we're talking about outputs. All right, so example three, find the domain and range of the function. Well, the domain, we'll just express that with a capital D. Remember, it's the set of all x values when we're looking at a graph. So I've got an x value here of -3, and that leads to a point. I've got an x value here of -1 that leads to a point. Here I've got an x value of +1 that leads to a point, and an x value of +3 that leads to a point. So here, reading the x-axis to find out what leads to those different outputs, those different y values. Then the range, that is the set of all the y values. So this first point of -3, it has a height of -2. We measure that on the y-axis. The second point, that has a height of 0 on the y-axis. The third point has a height of +2. And the fourth point has a height of 4. So all of those different heights, all of those different y values represent the range of the function. And since it's a set, we use our squiggled braces there. Now look at letter B. Here we've got something happening at -2, and then everywhere in between. It's a solid graph. I know that I'm getting points all along here. For every single x value, I'm getting some height, even if it's not on a grid line. So my domain is the set of all x's that are between, looks like an x value of -2 leads me here, an x value of +3 leads me there. And everywhere in between, we've got points on that graph. So between -2 and +3 is our domain. Now, since we had solid points on the ends here, we also include those points. So -2 is less than or equal to x, is less than or equal to 3. That represents our domain. And notice that we measured all that with the numbers on the x-axis, reading from left to right. Now let's look at the range. These are measured on the y-axis, so they're y values. I see a y value that would be -1. And then every other height, every other thing I could measure on the y-axis, I do have solid points there up until I get to a height of 2. So I know that my y values go from -1 up to +2. And again, we can express that using inequalities because it includes every single little point in between. All right, here are two that I would like you to pause the video and try these on your own. I'll check back in a few seconds. Describe the domain and the range. What are those sets of numbers? All right, for letter C, our domain is the set of all x values 1, 3, 4, and 6. And the range, all of the y values, we've got a y value of 5, another y value of 5, I don't need to list that again, a y value of 2, and a y value of -2. for the domain, we read the numbers from the x-axis. For the range, we read them from the y-axis. Let's look at letter D. Here, the domain is the set of all x's. Oh, and I don't want to start with an x there because I want anything in between those two points. So I start with an x value of 1, and I end with an x value of 4 right here. So anything between 1 and 4, including the 4, is part of my domain. And the range, now we're looking at the y-axis. I start off right here with a height of 1, and then I will see that graph all the way up, climbing, 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 until I reach a height of 7. So my y values go from a 1 up to and including a height of 7. And again, remembering that these ordered pairs are x, y, x, y. Our range, our outputs, should be using the y values. All right, final slide. Find the domain and range of each function. Pause the video, try this on your own, and I'll check back in a couple seconds with the answer. All right, for number 9 here, the domain is the set of all x values, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, and 2. And the range, those are the set of y values, 0, I see 2, and I see that twice. I only need to list it once in my set, and I see a height of 4. Same thing, I've got 2 points with that y value. I only need to list that y value once, that height of 4. For number 10, here our domain. Again, it's a continuous graph. It's not just points plotted. It's all connected. So I want all x values between 1 and 5. And I'm including 1 and 5, so I use 1 less than or equal to x, less than or equal to 5, to describe all those points in between. And then the range, the heights I see, I am at a height of 0 here. I can read that on the y-axis, and then I'll see that graph all the way up to a height of 4. Everywhere in between, I see that graph. So 0 less than or equal to y, less than or equal to a height of 4. And again, we use or equal to because those are solid points at a height of 0, solid points at a height of 4. We know we have that height. All right, and here is your homework assignment for section 3.1, day 1.